magyantimandasya gyananjalashalakaya chakshunmilitam dinna tasmai shri guve namaha shri chaitanya manupistam stapidam yena bhutale swayam upakaramayam nadati swapadantikam namaham vishnupada krishnapista bhutale shrimate bhaktivedanta swaminiti namane Namaste Saraswati Deve Govani Pachayane Nivashesha Shunyavari Pashyata Rishatarine Vanchakopa Jubasha Kripasa Nivevacha Paditanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadara Shri Vasadi Go Bhaktavinda Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Okay, so welcome everyone to our continuation on the topic of sheltering relationships, the foundation to devotee care. You think they remember to broadcast at 5? Yes? Okay, good. Because yesterday we had quite a few people watching over internet, so even though there's not so many people here, but let's hope our internet audience will be with us. Just quickly get organized here. So I assume... So I assume that most of you were here yesterday and you still have the materials of session number 2, right? Yes? If you haven't got them, we printed out some more there for people who maybe forget to bring them or for people who were not here yesterday. Yeah, actually this is just a little uncomfortable for me, even though I honor the Maha. Yes, so today we want to discuss part 2 of session 2. And this is a very interesting topic. It is basically the topic of envy. How envy manifests towards seniors equals in juniors. And just to make it clear at the very beginning of the discussion, this discussion is not meant that we detect the envy in others, but this discussion is meant that we detect the envy in our own hearts. Right? Yes. What does it mean if we, you know, use this discussion to detect the envy in others, that we think, oh yes, that's why my senior is acting towards me like this. This is actually envy. Oh yes, you know, and so on. And my equals are acting towards me like this, and my juniors, and. So what does that indicate? Envy, yes, exactly, exactly. So we don't want to, you know, fall into that trap to just one more time demonstrate our envy by pointing the finger at others and detecting the envy in other people's hearts. But no, it is meant that we detect it in our hearts, right? And there is in 5th canto, 18th chapter, verse number 9, there is a funny little thing in the word-for-word translation. There it says, kalaha, and then Prabhupada translates, the envious, and in brackets he puts, almost everyone. Almost everyone. So, almost everyone means, most likely we are also included in this. You know, because very often we like to think, because envy is such an ugly quality, actually. It is, you know, a very bringing about a very ugly and negative and poisonous feeling in the heart. And we like to keep ourselves in this illusion that no, we are not suffering from this. Everybody else is, of course, but no, not me. So, but that's why Prabhupada says almost everyone. So, as we already previously mentioned, envy comes along. As soon as sense gratification is the goal in life, envy and competition comes along, right? So envy basically comes about by us wanting to be the supreme enjoyer, controller, proprietor, you know? And then that feeling that we want to be the supreme, this manifests in all our relationships. If this kind of consciousness we have, that we want to be the supreme and the best and the center and all that. So that's a kind of a certain consciousness. And this comes out in all our relationships. Not only towards people who have something which we don't have, but even also towards inferiors. It also comes out because it's a state of consciousness, right? So, and we want to discuss now a nice verse. You have the number there on your materials, but I didn't print the whole verse because also afterwards you have this little, diagram here on your sheet, you know, envious behavior, non-envious behavior, then towards seniors, towards juniors, towards equals with dotted lines. So I want to read you this verse and purport, and I would like you to be attentive, and then we collect together what goes in there on the dotted lines. All right? Okay, so this is 4th canto, 8th chapter, verse 34. The chapter is Dhruva Maharaj leaves home. You know, where Dhruva Maharaj is insulted by his stepmother. Right? So there it says, I will skip the Sanskrit and just read the translation. Every man, and when Prabhupada talks here about man, it means human being, not man, versus a woman, of course. So every human being, it means human. Right? Yes. Well, it comes from manush, you know. The manu samhita. It's manu samhita. Manu means human being, you know. Yeah, so interesting to see the roots of it, you know. Every man should act like this. When he meets a person more qualified than himself, he should be very pleased. When he meets someone less qualified than himself, he should be compassionate towards him. And when he meets someone equal to himself, he should make friendship with him. In this way, one is never affected by the threefold miseries of this material world. That's already an interesting statement. That if we just learn how to act in a non-envious way, we are actually never affected by the threefold miseries of this material world. Wow, amazing. You know, so this envy is indeed the root cause for all our miseries. So now Prabhupada very nicely unpacks this verse. He says, generally, when we find someone more qualified than ourselves, we become envious of him. When we find someone less qualified, we deride him. And when we find someone equal, we become very proud of our activities. These are the causes of all material tribulations. Here we've got it again. The great sage Narada therefore advised that a devotee should act perfectly. Instead of being envious of a more qualified man, one should be jolly to receive him. Instead of being oppressive to a less qualified man, one should be compassionate towards him just to raise him to the proper standard. And when one meets an equal, instead of being proud of one's own activities before him, one should treat him as a friend. One should also have compassion for the general people in general who are suffering due to forgetfulness of Krishna. These important functions will make one happy within this material world. So here we got it one more time, that actually one can be happy in this material world if you just know how to act in a non-envious mood. And actually also in many other purports, Prabhupada is explaining that, you know, this is Vaikuntha atmosphere, non-envy. And that's why one can be happy in this material world, because if one actually acts non-enviously, then one lives in Vaikuntha, basically. Because that's the spirit there. There is absence of envy there. Because there is absence of sense gratification there, therefore also no envy. So, yes, Prabhu, we are discussing part two of the second thing, lesson, because we only discussed part one yesterday, so it's all about envy. We just started this 4.8.34, you know, how envy manifests towards seniors equals juniors. Yes, so that's ultimately why, you know, one can be happy in this material world if one is non-envious, because then actually one doesn't live in the material world in one sense. One is actually in the spiritual world then, you see. And Prabhupada also instructed us that this is actually the purpose of ISKCON, to create a society where there is no envy. Nice vision, you know, of our temple communities. That actually should be the goal. A little oasis of non-envy in this material world surrounded by envy. So now we heard the verse in purport, so let us collect. Envious behavior towards seniors. What was it in the verse in purport? How does that look like? Huh? Yeah, it said envious, but it said, you know, how the non-envious behavior is, so one can, you know, negate the non-envious behavior, and then one gets the envious behavior, you know. Anybody remembers? Yes. Yeah, that's the non-envious, but now, how do we receive the person? Envious behavior is not necessarily angry, but not jolly. Yes, exactly. We are not pleased to receive the person, right? There's even in Manu Samhita, there is a verse, actually somebody sent it to me the other day, but I haven't had a chance to include it. But there it straight out says, if one sees a devotee and is not joyful to see him, this is already a subtle form of offense. Because there is some envy there when we think, oh no, not that person, you know. Let's hope he will leave pretty soon, you know, and okay, oh hey Bob Prabhu, how long are you here for? Okay, oh thank God he leaves after 2 days again. So yes, this is envy, that one is not pleased to receive the person. not even a Hari Bol relationship. Did you get the materials? Yes. Could you kindly be our doorkeeper there and whoever walks in. But you please ask them if they were here yesterday and they have the materials, then no need to give it. Yes, I also cannot remember seeing her face before. Good. Yes. So, yes, we are not only not pleased, but what else do we do towards a senior who we are envious of? I mean, not being pleased to receive the person, that's a pretty mild manifestation of envy. But what else do we do? Yes? Be impersonal, yes. Yeah. So what do? We are not only not jolly pleased to receive the person, but we ignore the person, right? We just pretend the person is not even there. We don't give him any attention. We don't give the person any importance. We just ignore, right? And what else do we do, which is a little more powerful? Huh? Pray for them. No, when we are envious, we're not praying for them. Well, then you're not envious. Yes, yes, we put him down. We find fault. We criticize. Backbiting. You know, when somebody says, oh, such and such Babu led such a nice kirtan this morning, wasn't it? Then we say, yeah, it was nice, but, you know, he was out of tune. Oh, I didn't like his kato playing. Oh, the tune was not very good. Oh, you know. Yes, but, you know, we find some fault to minimize, to pull him down. And why do we do this? Because we want to establish, actually, I'm much better. You know? That's how this envy works. We use each and every situation to establish that we are actually superior. So, and that's why we do this. And these things are so subtle, you know? We don't even realize how often we do these things, and we might be thinking we have some justification because really his tune was not very nice or something, you know? And we think this gives us a justification to minimize him, but actually it comes out of envy. You know, even if the tune was not nice, what's the big deal? We still can be positive and you know, highlight and magnify the positive rather than, you know, finding something negative. That only magnifies the negative thing. It doesn't uplift anybody, not ourselves, not the person who hears it, not him who was leading the kirtan. It is not uplifting to anybody. So why engaging in it? Right? It is the only reason why we engage in these things is because we want to reduce the person's importance and establish that we are actually better. Right? Yes. Yeah, so that's the main ways how envy towards seniors manifests, that we are not pleased to receive the person, we ignore him, we backbite, fault find, criticize, diminish his position, we don't give him any importance. And yes, so, and what's the non-envious behavior now when we meet a person? All we have to do is take the opposite. So how do we receive him? Yeah, first of all, we are jolly, we are pleased to receive the person. And how do we associate with a superior? Humbly, respect, pariprajnena sevaya, right? We inquire and we offer humble service. This is the way how to, not only to, associate with guru, but with any senior devotee, actually. That's how we, you know, get some benefit and we take advantage of a senior person's presence, that we offer service and we inquire. Right? Pariprajnena, pariprajnena, that's pariprajna is inquiry and sevaya is Tadviripadipadena Paripashnana Sevaya in Bhagavad Gita, right? Yeah, so that's how we are meant to associate with one who is senior. So let's go to the next one. Envious behavior towards juniors. Who can remember? Yes. We are oppressive, we deride him. Actually, because English is not my first language, what exactly does deride mean? Does it mean we make fun out of him, or does it mean we are oppressive, or what does it actually mean? You criticize them, deride. But more from the top down, right? You want to crush him down. Okay, good. Yeah, because sometimes, you know, you hear these words and you kind of intuitively have some feeling for it, but then when you should exactly explain what it means, then I don't even know it exactly, you know, because it's a foreign language for me, English, you know. Okay, good. Yeah, so that's what it said in the purport. We deride them, or we are oppressive. Or what else do we do? Huh? Yes, you look down on them. You're condescending. You know, that's a good word to describe it. Condescending. You're from the top down, you know. Whatever you do or say, it comes with this mood, or you are down there and I am up here, you know. Again, that's the envious mood there, that we even in a relationship with a junior, we use that relationship in a subtle way to establish our superiority very clearly, right? Yes. So what else do we do? There's a few more little things. And for those who come late, once again, I want to express that this discussion is not meant to discover the envy in others, but in our own hearts. Because if we use this discussion to discover the envy in others, that means, again, we are envious, actually. So especially in this regards towards juniors, you know, we don't want that now people think, oh, that's why my senior is treating me like that. You know, he or she is actually envious. Then we are guaranteed we are committing some Vaishnava apparat in our own envy here. You know, so really, let's not allow ourselves to have these kind of thoughts coming into our mind, but we want to detect the envy in our hearts. That's the topic here, not in other people's hearts, right? Okay, so what else do we do when we are envious towards juniors? How does it manifest? Yeah? Yeah, we it can even go so far that we, you know, we try to block their advancement, we keep them down, or let's put it that way, we definitely don't want them to become more successful than we are, you know. All right, we uplift them, but only to a certain level, you know, just enough to make clear that, well, but I am superior, I am more capable. Right? Yes, and what else do we do? There's a few more. Envious behavior towards juniors. How does it manifest? By constant and harsh correction. It can be. Again, we have to treat this with care. If we tend to constantly and harshly correct people, then we should ask ourselves, well, maybe there is some subtle envy there. But if we are constantly and harshly corrected, you know, we should not think that that is envy or something. Maybe we just deserve it and need it just to be, you know, put in a more humble position or something. So again, we should not judge our seniors who are correcting us maybe or something. But if we have that tendency to constantly and harshly and heavily correct, this can very well be some subtle envy there, you know? And it's often like that when a new person joins the ashram, then everybody is so eager to correct that person. Or finally, we've got somebody here to correct, you know? And everybody bounces on this person and, oh, don't do like this and don't do like that. And the poor newcomer, he's completely bewildered. Nothing is right what he's doing, you know. And this can be very discouraging. So this should not be done. Actually, to correct others, it has to be our service to do this. Otherwise, if it's not our service, we shouldn't do it. Yes, just to make sure we don't give some room here to, for our envy to manifest. You know, this is really important. The other day, who was it? I think Satchinanda, no, Kadambakarna Swami, there was some little thing on Dandavats about this. And he said, we don't want to become a society of correcting each other, you know, that everybody corrects everybody here. And you know, everybody's just picking on each other there. No, it has to be our service to correct others. And also, interestingly, Vaishnava etiquette says that one has to be free of envy in order to correct others. And only then it is actually uplifting and purifying. But if there's envy mixed into it, I'm sure we have all been in that situation where we either we corrected others in an envious mood, or we were corrected in an envious mood. Again, it creates a very ugly feeling there in within our hearts. And that is this ego, this contamination which comes along through the ego motivation. So when we feel this burning desire, we have to correct that person, and we can hardly even control ourselves, and it has to be right now, immediately, and we all are agitated. Better not to correct in this situation. Better than to wait, sleep it over, you know, wait until you cool down, you know, because if we correct in that mood, oh, I'm sorry, I have to tell you, you know, this is, you know, not uplifting. Then better, you know, we have to be introspective, and we have to recognize this, and then better to wait whatever long time it takes for us to cool down. And also another good practical tip is to really be in a prayerful mood and say, oh, please Krishna, help me to correct this person in the mood of humble servant, being the well-wishing humble servant and friend to this person, and really me being his well-wisher. Let me bring this correction across in such a mood. And if we have that prayerful mood, it really works. Krishna helps. Because, yeah, the etiquette is we should not correct others if we are envious, but as we were saying, Prabhupada said, the envious, almost everyone, you know, in the word for word translation there of 5.8.18.9. So how can we correct somebody then, you know, if we have to wait until we are non-envious, or well, then nobody can correct anybody here or something, you know? So, but if we have this prayerful mood, oh, please Krishna, let me bring this correction across in this mood of being a well-wishing friend. If we have that prayerful mood, then we actually manage to do this, at least for those minutes when we correct the person. But as I'm saying, it has to be our service. If it is not our service, then better to, you know, point it out to somebody else whose service it is to correct that person. You know? That's really important. We can't just walk around and correcting everybody all the time. Because many things, you know, I mean, let's imagine if Prabhupada would have started the movement like this, correcting everybody all the time, then probably it wouldn't have been so successful. But Prabhupada knew some things, you know, they actually cannot just be corrected by words, but it is a matter of gradual purification and upliftment, and then things are falling into place. So some things have to be corrected immediately. Some things we can just overlook and let it go by, and eventually it will be rectified. So it really requires non-envy in order to see what things should be addressed and corrected, and what things we can just, you know, accept it as a lower level of that person at the moment, you know, because we can't simply correct things, you know, by being told all the time. Some things we can, but some things we're just not ready, and it takes time, you know, to purify and get the realizations, you know. Yes. Yes, let me see. Let's go back to the envious behavior towards juniors. Another way how envy can manifest is by ignoring a person's abilities. You know? By keeping him down, by ignoring his abilities. And again, we have to be careful, because sometimes if a person is a newcomer and he has a lot of material abilities, it is not bad to initially ignore them, just to let him become a humble servant first, because if we engage a person immediately according to his material qualifications, that can also boost his ego and actually poison his whole devotional life. So again, it's not that as soon as somebody is ignoring somebody's skills, especially as a newcomer, then, oh, he is envious. No, not absolutely like this. But it can be, especially if the person is not such a newcomer anymore, but he has been serving and you know, in a humble way for many years, and still then we are ignoring his skills, and we, you know, giving him engagement which is maybe a little too menial for him, then that could be envy. Or the other way round, and this is a little nasty, you know, that we are giving him services which are too difficult. And then we say, ah, just see, I knew you can't do it. Or maybe in a more hidden form, but the same principle, if we delegate some task to somebody, but then we are not following up. We are not asking him, so how are you going? Do you need some help? What obstacles are you facing? And. But we're just delegating, and we leave it all up to him now. And then afterwards we say, ah, just see. And unless I do it all, it's not going to get done anyway. So better I don't ask anybody else. I have to do everything here. You know? This is also some envy there, you know. And these things are not so uncommon, you know, that we don't like to delegate, because we want to do it all and we want to be the one who is the only person who can do it. And then, all right, we delegate, but then not in a well-wishing mood of following up and giving support ongoingly and checking up, how is it happening. When we delegate, we have to, you know, follow up. We can't just, you know, hand over the responsibility and not even look at all what's happening there. And then, oh, yeah, we'll just see. Nobody else can do it, only me, you know. Yeah, so this is also this envy underneath there. And let me see what else I have there. Yeah, and even making fun out of people, you know, on their expense. This is also some subtle envy there, that we are, you know, we have a good laugh, but for the person who we make fun out of, it's not that funny. And it is some, you know, some condescending way of putting the person down and, you know, ridicule him in some way. Okay, or also being very impatient, or I don't have time for you. You know, I'm such a busy and important person, I don't have time for you. Or I cannot work with him. You know, being too impatient and not having time for the other person. This is also, can very well be some underlying envy there. Yeah, so it is manifesting in so many different ways here. So good to be a little introspective and see, or maybe, you know, this is actually also coming out there from my heart and my dealings towards juniors. So now, what's the non-envious behavior towards juniors? Yes, Prabhupada said, compassionately uplift him to the proper standard, right? Affectionately uplift. Actually, non-envy means we always know how to connect with each and everyone for their upliftment. Doesn't matter who it is. And Prabhupada was a perfect example of this, right? He always knew how to act and how to connect in each and every situation with a person for their ultimate benefit, or for their upliftment. Doesn't matter whether it was a little child or some drunkard in some park, or, you know, some reporter or whoever it may be, you know. He knew exactly, because he was just 1,000% non-envious, he knew exactly, he saw, you know, the spirit soul there, and he knew how to act for their ultimate benefit. Yes, Prabhupada was really expert in this, you know. Yeah, very wonderful. Okay, and now, envious behavior towards equals. How does that manifest? What did Prabhupada say? Can you remember? Yes, we are proud. We are chanting our own glories. Right? And why do we do this? Again, to establish that actually we are a little superior after all. All right, we are equals. But actually, I'm a little superior. Right? So what else is there between equals and an envious? Exactly. Yes. There is quite a bit of competition there. Who is superior after all? You know? Yes. Let's imagine, you know, two traveling preachers are meeting, and then, you know, the one starts chanting his own glories. Oh yeah, I've been here, I've been there, look here on my phone here, the video, me leading the Harinam and the Kumbh Mela and this and that, and yeah, and then I went there and this and that. And it's all going on in the name of sharing. He's my friend, I'm just sharing. You know? Jai Sri Sri Gaudatai, Jai Sri Sri Ogmini Drakadish, Jagannath Baladev Subhadra Ki Jai. Yes, so it all goes on in the name of sharing. Oh, he's my friend. I just want to share with him what I all did. You know? But then there's this underlying mood of impressing him and establishing how far out we are. Right? And then at the end we say, and you also did something? Tell me about you. What did you do? You know? Yes. It's going on. It's going on. Yes, yes, yes. Or let's imagine two equally good cooks cooking lunch for Guru Maharaj. Who can be an intense experience. If it's one expert cook and one helper, no problem. You know, then the positions are clarified. But if they're two equally good cooks, oh, you know, Why are you cooking like this? Gumach told me. Don't you know his diet? And last time he wanted it like this. And, oh, what are you using? What? Don't use that. He doesn't like it. And, you know. I've seen it. People stealing each other's boga, stealing each other's pots, or trying to make sure that the preparation the other person cooked will not be served out. It's not according to his diet. Don't serve it. Yeah. I've seen it all going on. Or you don't share the recipe. No, that's my recipe. I'm not going to tell anybody. It's my secret. Just so nobody else can cook what I'm cooking for Gurmat. You know? Yes. Oh, it's intense. I mean, I don't know. Sometimes I'm asking my audience to divide in groups and prepare a little role play for tomorrow. You know, envious and non-envious behavior towards seniors. One group has towards seniors, one group has towards juniors, one group has towards equals. So I don't know whether you will be fired up for such a thing, but we would have the time to do it. And it's I like the tool of role plays. It's a very powerful tool which acts as a mirror, you know. We see ourselves there, you know. And it's good to use a really common daily scenario of an ISKCON temple. And yeah, it's quite a powerful, it deepens the whole learning experience. So I can simply put it in your mind, and then at the end we see whether anybody is fired up. It's just a 3-minute, I mean, I already presented it here almost, you know, two cooks cooking for Gumach, the envious behavior, what it looks like. Or two equally capable pujaris dressing up the deities for Janmashtami. Oh, can be, again, an intense experience. Whose idea is better? And no, let's do it like this, no, like that, and. Oh, you know, my God. Yeah, so that's the envious behavior towards equals. So what's the non-envious behavior between equals? Friendship. Yes, that's what Prabhupada said. Although, let's qualify it a little bit. Friendship. I mean, friendship you can have towards seniors equals juniors. So what is the special thing there in the friendship amongst equals? There is some special mood. There is also a kind of competition, but not the envious competition. It's a different kind of competition. What's the competition amongst equals who are non-envious? Yes, Prabhu? Exactly. Yes. Push each other forward. No, Prabhu, I want to hear from you. You give the lecture. You lead the kirtan. You know, oh, let me serve you. Let me inquire from you. What's your secret? How do you distribute so many books? And, you know. So on that basis is a very special sweetness there. Because there is this competition there who is more junior. And the two are competing to serve each other and inquire from each other, you know. And there is this very sweet and confidential exchange on the equal level, if they are non-envious. You know, that, oh, you tell me your secret, and now you tell me your secret. How you remain Brahmachari for 30 years, tell me your secret. And, you know. So it's a very special mood of friendship there, which is only available in that equal relationship, right? Yes. Yes. So, now my question to you, which one of the three is the most purifying association with seniors, with juniors, with equals? Which one is the most purifying?
Ha 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 ha!
One says seniors, one says juniors. Oh, well, then there's only equals left. So which one is it? All of them. Well, but one is especially purifying. Which one is the one which is especially purifying? Equals, exactly. Yes. The equal association brings the most biting and pinching form of envy from the most secret and hidden corners of the heart to the surface. Not so difficult to associate with senior and be the humble servant there. That's not so difficult, because we can hope that some of his glories will jump over to us. Oh, see, it's always me and Guru Maharaj there in the picture. I'm such a confidential servant. It's always me and him, you know. And because he's so special, that's why I'm the next most special person here, because I'm always close with him. So that's not so difficult. And towards juniors, well, not so difficult to surround oneself with the juniors and, oh yes, I'm their servant, and of course, you know, that's also not so difficult. But equals, there we have to show true color, whether we are humble servant or whether we want to be a little senior after all, right? Yes, that's why this competition is most biting there amongst the equals. Yes. Yes. Interestingly, most conflicts come about through the difficulty of equal association. Yes. You know, even within our communities, there's often some struggles, some conflicts, some power games, some ego battles going on. And this is especially amongst those of equal capability and equal influence. To share one's own influence with somebody who is similarly influential, this is the most challenging. Yes. And even wanting that person to be more successful than me, that's most challenging. You know? That we are afraid if somebody comes who is similarly influential, then, oh, maybe the devotees like him better than me. You know? And we don't like that. We feel, oh, we're losing control here and. And interestingly, especially pinching, that is, if the person comes to our circle of influence. Let's say two similarly influential people meet in Mayapur. This is not so difficult, you know, because both are lifted out of their circle of influence and they meet in Mayapur, no problem there. They can be friends and go in parikrama and go to lectures and kirtans. But you know, when they meet in their circle of influence, in the circle of influence of one of them, and he has to share his circle of influence, his influence with somebody similarly influential, or maybe even more influential. Ooh, this is most challenging. Yes, and we might even feel some little discomfort in such a situation. We might even avoid it intuitively because it feels a little uncomfortable. We don't even like this, you know? Yes. Yes. Nice example from the Shastra is Prithu Maharaj in Indra. When Prithu Maharaj wants to perform the 100th horse sacrifice, while he has 99 and Indra has 100, no problem. But as soon as Prithu Maharaj wants to perform the 100th, then Indra gets all envious. And what does he do? He steals the horse. My God, how much more envious can you be, you know, than stealing the horse so he can't do it? So I have the 100 and he only the 99. You know, and then the whole horse stealing goes back and forth. And it's also their followers. It's not only them directly, but their followers. Often the followers are more, you know, envious than actually the personality themselves. We even sometimes have this coming in, you know, in disciples of gurus, that there's a little bit of this kind of, you know, clashes there happening, these subtle wars going on and stealing the horse back and forwards type thing, you know. Yes. Yeah, so, and then, you know, Lord Prithu Maharaj only came back to his senses when Lord Brahma appeared on the scene and said, hey, no need for you to do 100 horse sacrifices. You're already a pure devotee. So let Indra have 100. You be satisfied with 99. So that reestablished him, you know, in his transcendental position. And then he gave up this whole envy and anger. And there is one purport where Prabhupada says both Prithu Maharaj and Indra were envious and angry. Yes, and I was surprised, you know, thinking, wow, Prithu Maharaj Shaktyavesha avatar, so, and he is angry and envious. I mean, of course, we can say maybe it's just for the Leela to take place. But then again, I personally also see this lesson in it, and even on the level of Prithu Maharaj, one can be infected, you know, by some momentary anger coming from Indra there, and that ignites that envious feeling also in Prithu Maharaj. And then due to the association of Lord Brahma, he immediately dropped it, you know? Yes. So that's how powerful envy is, very poisonous, you know? But it's a very nice example of this difficulty of equal association. And I mean, the Bhagavatam is full of them. There's so many others too, you know? Daksha and Shiva and all these battles there, you know. Yes. Yes. So, and we have a very nice formula here for association. Out of, this is Radhana Swami's formula, and as I understand, it's not a Shastric formula, but he gives this formula, as far as I understand, simply to emphasize how important the equal association is. And he says, out of 100% of our association, 60 should be spent with equals, 20 only with junior, and 20 with a topmost senior level. But 60 with equals, wow, that's, I mean, as a young devotee, you might have 60% of equal association, but the more we become so-called senior, the less we can actually implement this of 60% of equal association, you know? My God. I mean, when I heard this formula the first time, I was running to Narendra Swami and said, oh, Maharaj, I don't have 60% equal association. What am I going to do? You know, as a traveling preacher, it's almost impossible to get, you know, especially being in Bangladesh, Ukraine, there's many devotees are junior and so on, you know, so 60% equal association is very difficult, you know. And he gave me a good answer. He said, be alert in fear. Know that you're reading a risky life because you don't have the 60% of equal association, and that's a risk you take for the sake of preaching. And whenever you have the chance for equal association, take it, go for it, grab it, be eager for it. Don't try and avoid it. You know, because very easily the intelligence says, oh, I'm so busy with my preaching, I can't go to this festival there because I will not be the center of attention, and I better do my own programs or something, you know. And underneath is actually this envy that we don't want to take the senior or equal association, you know. Yeah, so that was his advice to me. Yeah, so, and now, of course, very often the question comes up, so How do we decide who is equal senior junior? Right, that's the obvious question. How to recognize? So, of course, the ultimate criteria is one's Krishna consciousness, one's power to uplift others. Actually, that's the ultimate criteria. But because this cannot be so easily, determined, that's why we accept more external criteria, which are almost a little mundane, you can say, a little material, not mundane, but material, external. So, of course, the most common criteria is how many years have we been in Krishna consciousness? When did we get first initiation, second initiation, right? That's the most common criteria we use. But again, it's a rather external criteria because a person can be around for 30 years and because he might have not applied himself so seriously to the process, he might not be so realized. But then another person who is not so many years in Krishna consciousness, he might be continuing from previous life. We don't know, And he might actually be much more Krishna conscious. So it is an external criteria, but somewhere we have to start. So yes, that's one criteria. Then also the mere age of a person. If a person is 20 years older than we are, that already in itself deserves, respect and to treat the person more senior because of his life experience. So, and then also the ashram, like the renounced order, sannyas is always considered superior to grihastha ashram, even though the grihastha might be a Prabhupada disciple and the sannyasi a next generation, but sannyas, is asking for seniority, Also, managerial position gives, is a criteria to consider that person as senior because he's got a managerial position, a title, even though he might be a younger devotee, like a GBC temple president. He might not be a Prabhupada disciple, but, a Prabhupada disciple will respect him in some sense as senior because of that position, right? So these are all different examples. But as I was saying, the ultimate criteria is one's Krishna consciousness. And there is a nice story illustrating this in the Bhagavatam. This is King Rahugana when he is carried on the palanquin by Jadabharat and he walks all funny trying to avoid the ants. And King Rahugana chastises him. So, and then Jadabharat gives this nice eloquent speech there saying, yes, today you are the king and I'm the carrier, but tomorrow might be the other way around. I might be the king, you are the carrier. And these are just designations and. So, and King Rahugana immediately recognizes, oh, my carrier is actually a self-realized soul. And he jumps off the palanquin and pays obeisances. So it's a very nice example that even though externally he is superior, he is in the king's position, but he immediately gives up that position when he realizes that actually that junior person is more Krishna conscious. So that's actually how Vaishnava acts. So initially he might act according to his position of external criteria, but then when he detects, or this person is actually more Krishna conscious, then he will take the humble position. And I mean, that's the humble Vaishnava mood anyway, to think, oh, everybody else is a devotee except me. So then we are always safe if we have that mood. But then sometimes due to serving and preaching, we might have to, or training others or whatever, we might have to assume the more senior role for the sake of doing our service. But then, as I'm saying, as when we meet a person who is actually more genuinely Krishna conscious, if we have some little humility, we will recognize that, just like King Rahugana. He could also very easily, he could have carried on and say, hey, you know, how dare you speak to me? I'm the king, I'm going to get you locked up or something. You know, he could have also reacted like this if he had been motivated by Ford's ego there, you know. But no, he immediately took the humble position. So it's a very nice example for that principle. Yes. Yeah, so let us now remember why again are we discussing this topic of envy in regards to giving and accepting shelter? What's the connection here? Yes, Baba. Yeah, when we are envious, it perverts the whole system. Not only it perverts, but what else does it do? Yes, we cannot give shelter and we cannot accept shelter. Or if we try, then it will pervert the system. But this is why, you know, envious person, we just discussed towards seniors, you know, he will avoid, he will ignore, he will criticize, you know, so obviously with that mood, how can he take shelter, right? And from the senior position, if we overly harshly and constantly correct and we are condescending and pushing down and all that, oh well, how can we affectionately reach out and uplift? So this envy is indeed the main and foremost thing which blocks us from giving shelter and accepting shelter. That's the issue. And as we were saying, the more materialistic life and its culture becomes, the more sense gratification is the goal of everything, the more envy and competition comes in. So, and therefore, the less we are inclined to give and accept shelter. You know? And that's why, at least me preaching this, I come across this quite a lot, that people, you know, say, oh no, thank you very much. I don't need anybody to stick my nose in my life and tell me what to do. I can very nicely work things out myself. I don't need a mentor. You know, people say this. Yes, they do. They do. Or they say, oh, this only works in India. Many people say that. They think this works only in India. But ironically, as I'm saying, the whole mentoring concept is not even originating from India, but from America, you know, from a Christian group. So actually, in any kind of culture where God is the center, this giving and accepting shelter is the natural way of association. It's not only some Vaishnav thing or something, but anywhere where God consciousness, you know, is people striving for, this should be the way of association and how to take care of the members of the community. Yes. So, and of course, we can say, yes, in India it works still better and more naturally because, yeah, the spiritual culture is still stronger there, even though it's also falling apart more and more. But that's why it works there, because these rules of etiquette are more deeply still understood. How we are meant to treat the seniors, how we are meant to treat the juniors. You know, this basic Vaishnav etiquette, it is more like still a tradition there. But it is also really falling apart now. India is becoming so materialistic. My God. Often even worse than in the West. Especially coming from the women's side. That the women all want to be, you know, career women and going for material success and earning big money and, oh my God, you know, this is stronger than in Germany. In Germany, it's already an old hat that the women enter the workforce and people are tired of it, and especially the ladies in Krishna consciousness, they're not so keen to have some whole big career. They're glad if they can be at home with the kids and go to the temple and do something there. But they don't want to, you know, have a whole big career unless they really have to or something. to maintain themselves. But in India, oh my God, because it's such a new thing that the women enter the workforce, and it's all prestige, and the parents are all proud. Oh, my daughter is a lawyer, and this and that, you know. Yeah, it's heavily going on, heavily. And from the men's side too, I mean, it's a bit off the topic, but, you know, I have met this, I came across this, that when a girl wants to get married, often the men ask, first question is, has she got higher education? Is she willing to earn money? And if she's not willing to work and earn money, they're not even interested to look at her. It's almost like getting yourself some money-making machine there or something, you know? Yes, yeah, that's the mood these days in cities like Bangalore and Mumbai. That's going on in our ISKCON communities. So India is not what it used to be like anymore. But anyway, but at least a few of these etiquettes are still there. You know, how to treat the seniors, how to treat the juniors, a little bit, this is still there, you know. So that's why in India, as a rule, this giving and accepting shelter is more natural for them, because they've still got the culture and the blood. And, you know, Prabhupada used to say, especially the Bengalis have Krishna consciousness in the blood, and all you have to do is scratch a little bit and it comes out, you know. Yes. Yeah, I really observed this, even in the second generation, when, you know, the young Indian folks grows up in the Western world, but still, they have that in the blood. They remember, yeah, my grandmother was like this, and so on, you know. So it's still lingering there with them, you know. Yeah, so now one other reason why we are discussing this topic of envy in connection with giving and accepting shelter is that actually any system of guidance and shelter really needs this element of equal association. We will come back to this a little later. You know, here we are discovering how important this equal association is, how it brings up, you know, brings out the most biting and pinching form of envy there, the most subtle one from the hidden corners of the heart. So this is just such a highly purifying thing. And especially shelter givers have to have a good portion of this equal association. By the way, this is also one reason why we established in ISKCON now every 2 years. Well, every 2 years we have the ILS, the ISKCON Leadership Sangha, and then every other year we have the Guru Sannyas GBC Sangha, where all the Guru Sannyasis GBCs meet for 1 week in Mayapur, and they spend some time together churning different topics. So one reason is because we recognize the importance of equal association. How important this is, how sheltering this is. Yes. And just to facilitate this, this was established every 2 years, like next year, 2019, in January or February, it will be again this Guru Sannyas GBC Sangha, where so many Guru Sannyasis GBCs come. And it's not management meetings, but it's just churning all different topics, you know, of, you know, yeah, vision, you know, churning some visionary topics and strategic planning things and all kinds of things, you know. Yes. Okay, so, yes, let me see. Yeah, well, let me ask, are there any questions, topics for discussion in this connection with the envy towards seniors, equals, juniors, just about that? Yes, in the back there. Well, as I mentioned, as far as I know, it's not a Shastric thing. I have never heard it from Prabhupada, but it is a thing that Varnaswami gives. You know? Even later, tomorrow and the day after, we will discuss the whole list of qualifications, what qualities we need to have to be a shelter giver. This is also a list which I didn't invent, but I got it in the Devotee Care Parampara. There's one nice book called Taking Care of Krishna's Devotees by His Holiness Niranjana Swami. So he gives that list of the qualities we have to give shelter. And I think he also didn't come up with it, but he got it of Radha Swami. So, and this is a little similar thing here with his figures, that Radha Swami mentions this. And as I mentioned, as far as I understand, he comes up with these figures just to impress on us how important this equal association is. That it is so important that we have to be really keen for it, consciously keen. Yes, because it's most purifying. And as I'm saying, the more senior we get, the more easy it is to dismiss it, you know, especially as a traveling preacher or guru or sannyasi. I mean, how much equal association you have? Maybe 5% or something, you know, at Mayapur or at some big festivals, but that's about it, you know. And I have observed that some personalities, such as Niranjana Swami and others, they make a conscious effort, they put consciously some emphasis on this equal association. You know, he really puts himself out to spend quality time with his god brothers. Like, as example, when Mukunda Maharaj had some surgeries there a couple of years ago in Australia, Niranjana Swami flew all the way to Australia, even though he had never been to Australia, and it was really, you know, he's busy enough with other things. But he flew all the way there just to spend some quality time with his godbrother Mukunda Maharaj. Yes. Yes. Oh, I also remember, you know, other personalities when they had some challenges in their life, maybe they had to give up their guru position or something. He went there, he spent, you know, 3-4 days with them in seclusion, went for forest walks and talked to them and encouraged them. And yeah, really, very, very nice. Yeah, very nice example, you know. Yes. Yes, Phil. That we take the association of like-minded devotees. Yeah, I mean, that's what Jiva Goswami says in that quote in the first session, you know, with those of similar moods and tastes, you know, similar goals and tastes, right? Yeah, well, I wouldn't say that necessarily like-minded. There can be still junior and senior be there, you know? Yes. Like-minded simply means we are on the same wavelength. We have the same mood, how we want to serve and what attitudes we have and visions of things. Because, yeah, Krishna consciousness, it's not all black and white, you know? There's so many ways and moods how to serve Prabhupada's mission and so on. So the like-mindedness is more there, whereas, you know, the equal association, we can almost say it is especially more purifying when you're not so like-minded. Yes. I mean, I don't want to mention any names, but I remember observing this with two Maharajas. You know, that even though they have such different approaches, how they develop communities or something, but still, they can be very good close friends. And this is only possible if you're not on the false ego platform. You know? As soon as there's Ford's ego there, it will not be so easy to be close friends, because there will always be this issue, whose approach is better? And they might try to convince each other that their own approach is better. Right? Yes. But with these two Maharajas, and as I'm saying, I don't want to mention the names, you know, it's a pretty personal thing. They might not like this when I'm commenting on their relationship like this. But I was really amazed to see how they can just completely go beyond those different approaches and have very deep and sweet time together and spend a lot of time together and are really good friends. But so different approaches. Actually, do we have a microphone so that our internet audience can also hear all these comments? Yes, yeah, so example is Jai Pitaka Maharaj and Tamal Krishna Maharaj. Yes, no, they are not the ones I'm talking about. But yeah, so Tamal Krishna Maharaj removed in 17 times from being the TP, and Prabhupada reinstated him 17 times. Yeah, so I mean, anyway, it's a little off the topic, but it's just an interesting point to see, you know, that one can be very close friends if one can overcome the different approaches, you know. But we are just more conditioned by false ego, and then we can only be good friends who have the same approaches like us. Right, otherwise the ego gets in our way, type thing, you know. Yes. Okay, good question. Once we detect the envy in our hearts, what do we do about it? Well, I have some 5 or 6 steps which I always recommend, and they work very nicely for any kind of transformational process we want to do, right? Whether it's envy or false ego behavior or whatever it may be. So, and you better write them down because they're not in your materials, but they're very practical and they really work, you know? Because actually the point is to really transform these subtle things like envy or false ego. As I mentioned maybe previously, I have a whole seminar on false ego. The false ego, our constant companion and troublemaker, I call it. Very insightful. I mean, it has given me so much help to detect my own ego there, because these things are so subtle. Ego, envy is so subtle. You very easily can completely miss it. You know, completely. And unless we do really some internal work, that we are introspective and honest, we have no chance to uproot this. No chance. Yes, it's really like that. So I'll give you the steps. Step number one is always hearing about the topic. Like we have now discussed how envy comes out. You know, so that makes us more mindful, more conscious, more aware that we know. You know, how does it manifest, right? Hearing is always the first thing. That wakens us up from our spiritual coma here. So we have to hear. Then step number two is desiring. You know, that should be the natural result of hearing, that we think, oh God, I really want to get rid of this envy. I want to kick it out of my heart. You know, that there has to be a burning desire that we want to become non-envious. That's step number two. So then step number three is be introspective and honest. Look within your heart. Why am I doing this? Why am I saying this? What is my motive? It requires almost constant reflection and introspection. In honesty, we are so expert in always cheating ourselves. You know, that's one effect of the false ego, saying, oh, it's all right, you know, you've got all the rights to be like this and say this, you're right, everybody else is wrong, we point the finger at others and, you know. So we have to be honest and introspective and really see what's going on in our heart. So then step number four is, catch yourself doing the wrong thing. That's already progress, that we catch ourselves doing the wrong thing. That's already progress, because before we were doing the wrong thing and we didn't even realize it was the wrong thing. But now, you know, we realize, oh, here we go again. I was overly chastising and correcting this person, and actually I am envious. You know, we catch ourselves doing the wrong thing. That's already progress. So the next step, we cry out and lament, oh Krishna, when will the day come when I can finally let go of this envious behavior? When, oh when, will the day come? There has to be some lamentation, and we turn towards Krishna. We cry out, please Krishna, help me, because ultimately these subtle and deep-rooted things like envy, that, you know, we carry them already for so many lifetimes in our subtle body with us. Actually, we out of our own strength. Jai Shri Shri Guru Jai Shri Shri Rukmini Dwarkadi Shri Jagannath Baladev Subhadraki Jai. We out of our own strength, we cannot even free ourselves from this. They're like demons, and we have to invite, you know, Lord Nrisimhadev with his sharp nails to do some heart surgery there, you know? Yes. So that's why we have to lament and cry out to Krishna. Right? So now, if we do this internal work of being introspective, catching ourselves doing the wrong thing, crying out and lamenting, if we do that repeatedly, then sooner or later we will get to the next point, where we actually catch ourselves doing the right thing. It will happen. It works. I can speak from practical experience. I've been doing this for the last few years. Not even so long ago that I started with this. Yes. One needs some little purification to even get to this understanding. You know, nobody was telling me or recommending me these things. So, I probably wasted quite a few years by not doing these things. Yes, so if we do this, then sooner or later, we come to a point where we think, oh, wow, this time I reacted differently. You know, 6 months before, I would have taken the opportunity to, you know, establish my superior position here and. You know, but now I was just quiet and let it go by, and I didn't respond and I didn't defend or whatever it may be. You know, so then we realize, wow, this is actually working. Krishna is so kind. He's actually helping us along. So like that, we'd make some little baby steps there in the right direction. See, and when we agree to do this internal work, that's actually when we make advancement. Yes. It's a whole internal process, this Krishna consciousness. Sometimes we think we make advancement when everything goes smoothly and we're getting up in the ladder of hierarchy there and this and that, and we become a big important person or something. But no. When we agree to do this internal work, that's when we get some purification, when we actually make advancement. Yes. Without this internal work, we can almost do the opposite of what we should be doing. We can really feed and blow up our false egos instead of subduing and diminishing it. You know, Krishna conscious practice gives plenty of opportunities to feed our egos, and we are going for it very often. You know, Even Facebook, you know. Or the pictures we are posting of ourselves. No, no joke. Oh, it's having, you know, tremendously bad effect on the false ego. I once read, Bhaktisiddhanta Sarasvati Thakur said to his disciples, while I'm in this world, you cannot publish pictures of me in public. It's not good for my false ego, he was saying. When I'm dead and gone, you can, but not while I'm in this world. And of course, Bhaktisiddhanta was free of false ego, but he gave this instruction for our benefit. And I'm sometimes wondering, what would he have to say about Facebook, where everybody's so eager, you know, to post pictures of themselves. Oh, here it's me and the women all with open hair and this and that. And oh my God. Yes, we don't even realize what effect this has to our false ego. That's why I personally stay away from Facebook. I'm not advanced enough. I do have a Facebook page of our institute there, but it's not a personal one, and I let somebody else manage it, and I'm just sometimes looking what she's posting there. But no, this whole Facebook thing, it's not for me. Yeah, I completely stay away. Or the selfies. Oh, this is me here and me here. Really, I mean, Maya has gone high tech, as Jayadvaita Swami always says, you know. Yes. And I mean, people kill themselves with taking selfies, you know. I heard India has the highest death rate of, you know, while taking selfies, getting run over and falling over the cliff or something, being so enamored there. Yeah, no, it's terrible. Yeah. Okay, well, is there any other question about the topic of envy? Maybe, would you like a little break? You have a question? Okay, last question about the topic of envy. Okay. That's a bit of a little bit of a involved question. Me as a woman traveling preaching, how envy comes towards me from the man. Well, I mean, to some extent I'm discussing this in this book, Spiritual Culture, Krishna's Divine System. I have one chapter there about women lecturing, you know, because there is such opposing moods. Some in some parts of the world, some personalities say women should not give any lectures. Some parts of the world, people are the opposite. Any woman can give lectures, you know. So, but the Bhaktivinoda Thakur has something to say about it, you know. So I'm discussing that in the book. It's too involved now. I don't want to go off the track. And it's another opportunity for me to advertise the book. Yes. Yeah. No, because I mean, these are all hot issues, you know. Yes. And I'm trying to give a very balanced presentation on this, because there is so much imbalanced things going on, you know. But just in short, you know, in spiritual culture, it's not that a woman cannot lecture. I mean, in Bangladesh, it's never been a question whether I can give a class or not. It was never questioned anywhere there. But also, you know, they wouldn't really put a young, pretty lady with, you know, lipstick and bangles and earrings and silk saris on the Vyasasan. When I tell them that in the Western world, You know, ladies like that also sit on the verses and they crack up laughing. Oh, really? Okay. You know, they think this is a little bit of a Russell Bass, you know, sitting on the verses and you're meant to represent Vyasadeva and one should be a little off the bodily platform. But anyway, I don't want to get into that whole thing, you know, because, and also, as I'm always saying in the book, it's not, I'm not trying to say what's right and wrong. I'm simply trying to give some insights into Krishna's system. How is it there? And then it's up to us how far or close we want to be from Krishna's system. That's an individual thing, you know? So it's not a question of what's right and wrong. But just as a little food for thought, you know, I can share this, that, you know, in spiritual culture, they would not want to have somebody on the Vyasasan who is not a little bit off the bodily platform. And that's for the man too, you know. I know one preacher in Europe, in a man's body, he has dyed hair with streaks in it and little earrings. And he's really popular, but I'm sorry, I find it hard to hear from such a person, you know, sitting on the Vyasasan talking about the bodily concept of life and then has, you know, blonde streaks in his hair. Ah, oh, Hare Krishna, you know. Yeah, I mean, according to my, you know, understanding, such a person should not maybe sit on the Vyasasan, you know. So it's for both genders there. But anyway, let's not get sidetracked. So my question is, would you like to have a little break? But please do me a favor and don't zoom off and not come back. This sometimes happens in breaks that people sneak off, you know. Because we do want to start at least, let's see how far we get. We do want to start with the next lesson, number 3. Where we discuss 3 very important qualities we have to have in order to be eager for shelter. So this is a pretty important topic. Now we basically concluded it, you know, looking from all different sides, why this taking shelter is so important, and we discussed what blocks us the most, this envy. So now we are moving on to a new chapter here, the qualities we have to be keen for shelter. Okay, so all right, it's 6:45 or 6:45, so let's say 6:55 we meet back here again. And if somebody wants to use the opportunity to get a book, I've actually only got these 6 books left. That's all I have for LA. I've got some books for other yatras, but if they are all gone, we'll make a list and people put down their names and I will get them sent. So there's plenty of books available. Okay, let's have a 10-minute break. $10, but if this is a little much for you or something, you can give